I'm glad there's so many families here tonight. Don't introduce me to your kids after the show. I am not what you would call a role model. I have three nephews under the age of 5 who are insane for Sesame Street. And I can do the voice of Elmo. I get those nephews to do stuff for me like they were my own personal Sesame Street servants. It's awesome. I'm like, hey, do you want to be Elmo's friend? Yeah. Hey, do you want to do something for Elmo? Hey, go get Elmo a beer. Go get him a beer! And listen, my nephews are 2, 3, and 4. Dang near stupid, okay? They think I'm Elmo. They will do whatever I say as long as I use the voice. Stupid. I can say,
okay, this is what Elmo wants you to do. He wants you to walk up to that hot girl, spank her on the hiney, and say, who's your daddy?
And they'll do it! To complete strangers at church. They don't care at all. They don't care. I love that voice. I love playing prank phone calls using the Elmo voice. I like calling radio stations. I don't call just any radio stations. I like to call the hardcore rap Def Jam radio stations. Because those DJs answer the phone really, really hard. And it's live. You can't edit that out. I'll call out the, yeah, boy, this is 101.9 WKZQ, dog. This is DJ E-Flow on the phone. Who am I talking to, dog? Who do I got on the phone? I'll be like, this is Elmo!
Hey, DJ, can you play that song that goes, yeah? Uh-huh, you know what it is? Black and yellow.
Look at all the old white people over here. They're like, what the heck is black and yellow? What is that? Is that like a bumblebee or something? Well, we're allergic to bees. We didn't bring our EpiPens. We gotta go. I love that voice. You know who hates the Elmo voice? Cops, no sense of humor at all. None. Any cops in here tonight by a round of applause? No, great. Let's talk trash about them. Here we go. I did a show in Las Vegas and I was lost and there was a cop car with 2 cops sitting in the car, parked in the median, doing nothing. Oh, I know, shocker, right? I got out of my car, walked up to the cop car, tapped on the window and said,
can you help me? Can you tell Elmo how to get to Sesame Street?
Right. The one cop looked at the other cop, he got an attitude. He was like, oh, a character. But isn't that hilarious? Can you do anybody else? I was like, actually, officer, I can. I can do the voice of the Count. Do you remember the Count? The vampire guy? I jumped right into it. I just looked at him and said, Vaughn, little piggy in a cop car. Two little piggies in a cop car. And they will arrest your butt for that in Vegas. Yes, they will. Watching a lot of cartoons. I met my first hardcore drug users when I was only 6 years old. I am, of course, talking about Scooby-Doo and Shaggy. Can we get on board with this? Part of becoming an adult is realizing those two characters were high all of the time. And you could tell because they were never really scared of the monsters. They were more concerned with the munchies. Like they'd see a monster, like Zoink Scoops, check it out, there's a vampire. Yeah, maybe he's got some Scooby snacks. And they had the dumbest ideas in the world. Watch that show as an adult. Only a stoner would have these stupid thoughts. They would be in a haunted castle in the middle of the night, pitch black dark, and hear a noise like Zoinkscoops. Did you hear that? Yeah. Like maybe someone's baking a cake. What are the odds someone's baking a cake? In a haunted castle. In the dark, only a pothead would think, like, maybe there'll be cake. I told my mom at 6 years old, she got furious. She was like, you know what? Maybe they weren't high. Maybe that is the way the characters were created. I was like, Mom, let's be honest. Shaggy could talk to a dog. Like, have you ever thought you might be high? And you look at your dog and say, hey, dog, I could really go for a pizza. If your dog looks back and says, yeah, me too, guess what? You're high. Get a van, find some friends, solve some mysteries. Thank you. And I wasn't always a full-time comedian. I used to be an elementary school teacher. Do we have any teachers or retired teachers in the audience? What do you teach, ma'am? What do you teach? Fourth grade, that's awesome. Clap for her, that's impressive, yeah? Someone clapped over here. I don't want to leave anybody out. What do you, sir?
Band teacher.
Band teacher. Sorry, we were looking for real teachers. Real teachers only. I'm sorry, I didn't. The band, is that doing that? That's just eight periods every... No, that's band, that's important. Clap for him too. I taught elementary school, ma'am. I was a fifth grade teacher. I graduated in 2005 with an undergraduate in elementary ed and a master's in educational technology. I got my first job, walked into the classroom, hanging on the wall was this, at the time, brand new invention they called a smart board. Clap if you've heard of a smart board or a Promethean. If you don't know, a smart board is like a huge iPad. It hangs on the wall. You can write on it with your finger. A standard smart board comes with 130,000 educational videos. 130,000! Let me take you back. Adults, do you remember our video experience when we were in elementary school? They would roll in that one rickety AV cart with the TV duct tape to the top. And we would all get that warm, fuzzy feeling in our tummies like, oh, we ain't learning nothing today. We didn't have 130,000 videos. We had one, and we watched it over and over. I'll prove it. Finish the song. Conjunction, junction. People under 25, they're like, what is that? What is that? Is that like a cult or something? I'm not drinking the Kool-Aid. You can't. I want to hear some Bill Nye. That's my jam. It is an amazing piece of technology. The last year I was a fifth grade teacher, we did a Skype experiment with our smart board. We did the same experiment as a fifth grade class in China to see if the results of the experiment would be different on opposite sides of the earth. Advanced technology. Let's go back. Adults, do you remember our advanced technology? When we were in elementary, you'd go to your best friend Jimmy, he'd pull out that paper diamond thing and go, pick a color. Green, G-R-E-A-N. What's it say? You're a jerk. Ah! Y'all are fun. I like fun people. I like people that want to laugh, have a good time. Do not like people that want to heckle and fight and get in my face. Because I don't know if you can tell from where you're sitting, but this body right here, not made for fighting at all. No. Way too skinny to get in a fight. Can we agree by a round of applause, skinny people are useless in a fight? Useless in a fight. In fact, the only thing skinny people can do in a fight is tell the cops what happened after the fight is over. I got so paranoid, I joined a gym to bulk up, and it's not working. The gym I joined, all of the machines are pneumatic, which means they use pressure rather than weights. That's terrible for a skinny guy like me because now I can't even bench press air. Big strong guys like you, sir, are walking through the gym like, how much you got on there? I'm like, nothing! I joined Gold's Gym for 2 days. Clap if you know what the Gold's Gym is. Hardcore lifters work out at the Gold's Gym. Bodybuilding behemoths. And when they work out, they get focused and they make noises. That's good info to know. I was at the gym my first day. I saw a man go right like this. He was like. Like, is he lifting weights or passing a kidney stone? I don't make noises at the gym like that. I make tiny man weightlifting noises. I'm doing curls. I got a little bit of weight on the bar. I sound like a broken choo-choo train. Just... One. The front row's like, that train needs maintenance. Another reason I don't like Gold's Gym, locker room etiquette. Ladies, I bet you didn't know this. Men walk around in the locker room butt naked. They're proud of their bodies. That's unacceptable. Because they all look better than me. I was getting changed my second day at the Gold's Gym. This guy came up to me ripped, just chiseled, no clothes. He was like, bruh. Check it out. I can crack a walnut with these glutes. And then he went right like this. This is a thing. He went psh, 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 psh. Right, good seats, right, ladies? Good seats. Look at, they're like, we haven't even eaten yet. And other chicks are like, Hercules, Hercules. I wasn't impressed. I was like, so you can crack a walnut with your glutes, big deal. Cause who would want to eat the nut after? What's that nut taste like? Tastes like booty. That's nasty. I will have my nuts gluten-free. That's not a joke they get like 40 minutes north of here, could you? They're like, what kind of nut is that? Is that like a macadamia nut right there? Is that like a salted cashew from Salt Lake? I will tell you this too, skinny people, if we ever get into a fight, we don't fight fair. I don't fight for fun, folks. I fight to live, dang it. That's what I do. I will cheat to win. I have been in one fight in my entire life. I won it hands down. Accidentally got into a bar brawl. And I told the guy, I don't like your attitude. I will see you in the parking lot 5 minutes. We will handle this like men. And he showed up. So I hit him with my car. Which to me was fair, because I was like, duh, meet me in the parking lot. That's where you keep cars. I got drafted into a bar fight. I say drafted because I did not want to participate. But sir, a big guy like you picked me up off of my bar stool. And he threw me like a weapon into the opposing team. My chest hit somebody in the head and he fell and tried to sue the bar. So I had to go to court. Listen to me. This was the most embarrassing day of my life. Because when I got to the courtroom, they wouldn't let me sit with the other people. I had to sit in the dang evidence section. They didn't call me by my real name. They kept referring to me as Exhibit A. The judge goes, how do you plead? I said, like a little girl. He said, what I don't understand is how come you just didn't fight back? I said, Your Honor, my car was in the shop. And because of the ruling of that court case, this 119-pound body is now considered a deadly weapon. I'm gonna start showing up in the game of Clue. Gonna be like, it was Colonel Mustard in the library with the skinny blonde kid. Threw it right at him, he did, what? And I love that joke, because look at all the pretty girls under the age of 25. You have no idea what I'm talking about. You're like, what the heck is Clue? What is that? Is that like a Facebook app or something? I don't even know, Tiffany. Someone tell me I'm pretty. Tell me I'm pretty.
Y'all are pretty.
And I'm married, too. Are you guys married?
Yeah.
Yes, that's awesome. Good.
Tiffany.
And you're Tiffany. Look at that. Nailed it. Listen, people, there's a reason I'm on this stage, okay? It's because I'm a professional, okay? By the way, I'll give you back your Social Security number after the show. I stole it 3 months ago to get ready. Oh, that Tiffany, how long y'all been married? 12 years. That's all. That's beautiful. That is amazing. I will tell people, now let me, does she make you do things you don't want to do? Look at him. He's like, I'm here, aren't I? I can't make this up. I've been married to my wife for 7 years. She makes me do things I don't want to do. The first year I dated her, sir, she made us take our very own Valentine's Day photos at Sears. Let that sink in. As a grown human being, I had to wear a red shirt with a pink tie, sit on a white box, and make a heart with my hand right like this. And when she saw the photos, she loved them. She was like, oh my gosh, these are adorable. I'm gonna buy every single one. I'm gonna go home. I'm gonna put them on Facebook. Everyone is gonna know that we're so in love. I said, please. Don't put these photos on Facebook. Because I have horrible Facebook friends. Sure enough, she put one photo on. 10 seconds later, I got a comment that just said, queer. I was like, wow, thanks, Mom. What a jerk. Some of y'all know her. Awesome. We've been married 7 years. I finally figured out some of my wife's quirks. If you don't know what a quirk is, it's a unique behavior that only your girlfriend or wife possesses. Sometimes it takes many years to learn a quirk. I learned one after only 2 years. We were married and sleeping in the same house in the same bed, and I have a schedule. Every night I'm not touring. I wake up 3:30 in the morning to use the bathroom. I'm out of the bed. Minute and a half tops. Every time I get back into the bed, my wife will ask me from half asleep. She'll say, honey, is that you? I'm like, you better hope. I'm a nice guy. I normally lean over, kiss her on the forehead. Yes, honey, it's me. Go back to sleep. Except this one time. She said, honey, is that you? And I leaned in real close to her ear and I said, nah, girl, this is Tyrone. And without skipping a beat, she said, oh, Tyrone, I have missed you. So I don't go on long tours anymore. I fly home midweek. I sneak in the back door. Poof, you in here, Tyrone! Meet you in the parking lot! Been married 7 years. 4 years ago, we decided to start a family. I ran into infertility issues. We decided that we wouldn't let that stop us, our dream of having a family. So 3 years ago, my wife and I got on an airplane and we flew to Kenya, Africa, and we adopted and brought home our very own baby. And folks, we could not be happier. Thank you. Hey, I'm thrilled. Thrilled because finally my wife gets to be a mommy. And I'm happy for me because finally someone in my family's gonna be able to dunk. This child has been nothing but a blessing to our family. I am from Southern Virginia. If you adopt a child outside of your culture or skin tone, people sometimes feel the need to ask you stupid questions. We were playing with our baby in a park and saw a woman who we knew. This is the conversation we had. She goes, I have a question. How is the baby supposed to know you're the parents? Well, because y'all are white and the baby is black. Let's say the baby is playing in a park and you call the baby's name. How is the baby supposed to know who to run to? Very inappropriate question. I gave an inappropriate answer. I said, oh, Barbara, there's a video for that. It came out in the 90s. It's all about Africa. What I do is I walk out into the park and I say, hi, Sibuanya, Baba Si, Si Baba. Comes running, I pick the baby up and go like this. All the animals in the park bow. My wife says, Hakuna Matata. And she said, I had no idea. You are not getting a Christmas card this year, Barbara. People say dumb things. It's 2017. It boggles my mind that people say dumb things. I have fun with it, because if you try to make me feel inappropriate, I'm definitely going to make you feel inappropriate. I was holding my daughter. The third week she was in the country, we were buying supplies at Walmart, and a security guard came up with his hand on his gun, and he said, when'd you get her? And I knew what he meant, but I said, oh, we got her on Black Friday. He's like, well, all right then. We had a nursing home in Matthews. It's a convalescent center. Last Thanksgiving, we took Ella. Oh, people love babies. She was running around, blowing kisses, giving high fives. Everybody loved her, except this one old white woman. She was like 197, just bitter. She goes, I got a question. How come you didn't get a white baby? I was like, ma'am, because it was after Labor Day. You can't do nothing white after Labor Day. Them's the rules. She was like, well, that makes sense. I was like, no, it doesn't. I want to kick you, but you're in a wheelchair. I can't do it. And my wife is beautiful. My daughter is beautiful. That's the number one question we get asked. Did you pick your daughter out? No, we did not. Most people don't know this. If you adopt a child outside of the United States, when we brought our daughter back, you immediately have to take the baby to a pediatrician. So my wife goes to fill out adoption paperwork at the courthouse. I have Ella for the first. Now, this is the first time I have ever been alone with my daughter as a father. I'm losing my mind, okay? And the doctor in charge is slinging information at me, throwing it. One of the things she says is, Mr. Bohn, you have adopted a beautiful African-American baby. Couple things you need to understand about African-American skin. It's not like Caucasian skin. In fact, it dries out a whole lot easier. What I suggest for your daughter, because she's so young, is you take something natural, something out of your kitchen cabinet, like olive oil or coconut oil. You rub it into the baby's skin. This will act as a natural moisturizer, keeping her skin from drying out. I was like, whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa, whoa, time out, back up. I'm gonna need you to write that down. She was like, why? I was like, because my wife is never gonna believe that's a thing, ever. I can barely marinate a steak, much less a black person, okay? I don't know how comfortable I am basting a baby, all right? The grandparents are coming today. They can't walk in and be like, where's the grandbaby? I'll be like, well, she is marinating, drip drying in the basement. I got some rosemary and thyme on her. She'll be ready in 3 to 6 hours. But she's beautiful. She is stunningly beautiful. I don't say that lightly. I know what I look like. This is a 5.2 in low light, okay? But I know what this looks like, and my daughter is beautiful. And I have friends that try to bring my daughter's beauty down onto their regular level. They will joke around with me at barbecues. They'll be like, you know what, Lucas? Maybe when Ella and Patrick get older, they'll date. I'm like, the heck they will! No. No, my daughter is a princess, and your son looks like he should be ringing a bell somewhere in France. Tell Quasimodo to get away from my princess, all right? And I know, this is the joke that divides the people, because all the guys laugh and all the girls are like, nope, nope. Babies are precious gifts from heaven above. Yes, they are. But some babies look like they fell from heaven and hit everything on the way down, okay? Look. Let's be honest with our, be real for a second. It's dark, nobody can see you laugh. Be honest with yourself, okay? Listen, okay? You ever see a baby so ugly, it makes you make a noise you weren't planning on making? Your friend will say, here's a picture of Tyler. Oh, dang. Oh, no. I wasn't ready. I want to back up. I'm going to do it again. I'm sorry. I got a bad heart. You can't creep up on me with a baby like that. You got to text me or call me, do something. You just can't. Oh, gosh. It's in the back of my throat right here. Turn them around. And I'm going to be honest with you. That's why I have black friends, because black people are honest. They will tell you to your face if you have an ugly baby. But black people have tact. They won't just say you got an ugly baby. They'll say something like, dude, that baby needs church. And then they start humming. This whole section's looking around like, all right, are there black people in here? Can we see if they're laughing? Because we're going to laugh at that when we get in our car. We're going to laugh at that. We're going to have a good chuckle, but I don't want to be inappropriate here. She is awesome. She's doing so good. And our family has just welcomed her with open arms. Before we adopted Ella, the youngest baby that we had in our family was my younger nephew, Aaron. Now, Aaron and I are two peas in a pod. We are the same person 29 and a half years apart, okay? We are the same. I am not actually allowed to hang out with Aaron anymore because I am not what you would call a role model. Here is the story. 2 years ago, we were in Colorado celebrating Thanksgiving. Aaron's sitting next to me because we're buddies. He reaches for a sippy cup, accidentally knocks a wine bottle off the table with his elbow. I see this happen out of my periphery. I lunge, somehow catch the wine bottle before it hits the floor, land on my side, the chair turns over, the whole family goes, and I thought it would be funny. I lock eyes with Aaron and I go, hey, like a dang ninja. Thought it was over. Mm-mm, not to a three-year-old. Because a couple months later, we're back out in Colorado for Aaron's preschool graduation. 65 3.5 to 4-year-old kids all walking up on stage. Little girl in front of Aaron slips on the back of her white dress, starts to fall backwards. It was like slow motion. The whole auditorium was like, no. Aaron steps up, catches this little girl, puts her back on her feet. The whole line continues to their seats. He gets to his chair, takes his cap off, looks right at the family and goes, hey, like a dang ninja. And I look right at his mom and I just said, that's just bad parenting right there. She said, you can't hang out with my baby anymore. This whole section's like, we should pray for him. Don't pray for me. Don't waste your time. I'm Catholic. I know I'm going to heaven. We invented it. Are there any other Catholics in the audience by a round of applause tonight? Just me. It's okay, I'll forgive you. And because I go to a black church, the whole front row is like, I think I'm burning. The water hurts. Sorry. I love being Catholic. I love it because it's the most forgiving religion in the world. Okay, we have a thing called penance. If you repent your sins in the Catholic Church, all is forgiven. For my brother's bachelor party, we took him to a show place. I repented to my wife. My wife is Methodist. Turns out Methodists are not as forgiving as Catholics. No. I said, honey, what would Jesus do? She goes, if you ever go back to a place like that again, I will arrange a meeting. So now we have a family. We also recently added another member to our family. We adopted a puppy from the animal shelter. Does anybody here have a dog or a puppy at home as a pet? You got a dog? That's awesome. What kind of dog is it, sir?
Husky
and a lab. You have a dire wolf at home, sir. You have a big, and what do you have, sir? What did you?
Pug Chihuahua.
A pug Chihuahua. That doesn't happen naturally, ma'am. I think that's a felony. I'm not sure. Pug Chihuahua, just like the pug was just running into the wall, the face is flat, and the Chihuahua was like, that's attractive. My dog is unique. She only has three legs. She got hit by a car when she was a puppy. They had to amputate her front left leg. We got her from the shelter. I see the looks on your faces. Some of y'all are like, oh, don't. My puppy doesn't know she's handicapped. She can do everything all the other neighborhood dogs can do. A couple weeks ago, she caught and killed a rabbit. I was like, that's what I'm talking about! My wife lost her mind. She's, you're not gonna believe what happened. My puppy has killed a rabbit. There are pieces of rabbit all over the backyard. I took the rabbit's head and I threw it over the fence. She went and got it and brought it back. I feel terrible for that rabbit. I said, time out. Don't feel terrible for that rabbit. That rabbit stinks at being a rabbit. How do you get caught by a three-legged dog? Look. Rabbits eat carrots and carrots make your eyesight better. What? That rabbit couldn't see. My dog only had three legs. Hello. Rabbit, you can't be lazy. You have to zigzag and jock and weave. Because if my puppy is chasing you and she tries to turn, she got no traction on the left side, she tips over, you live another day, rabbit. This dog has been great with our daughter. The only challenge, she gets very excited, agitated around other animals. Our next door neighbor had 12 ducks. Thank you for getting that. My puppy got into the cage, accidentally murdered all 12 ducks. Owner was distraught, called me and said, do you know what your dog did to my ducks? I said, time out. Do you have Aflac insurance? Other next door neighbor, fully grown Rottweiler. My puppy Rottweiler get into a fight. My puppy wins the fight. I think the owner of the Rottweiler was embarrassed. He called the cops on my handicapped puppy. I am not proud of this, but when the officer came for a statement, I lied for my three-legged dog. He was like, sir, what happened? And I said, I'm gonna be honest with you, officer, I don't know. But let me tell you what I do know. When my puppy left my yard this morning, she had four legs. Whatever went down was in self-defense. I gotta wrap this show up. You guys have been great. I will say this after the show, if you wanna take something home, I have a CD. It's on SiriusXM's Laugh USA, the comedy channel. It's clean. Please take it home. All of the money goes to my wife. That's not a joke at all, no. My wife and Ella run our house like the mafia, okay? Money comes in, it just doesn't go out. I have no idea where it is. But if you want to take one home, it's clean comedy. And I will leave you guys with this. You guys have been absolutely amazing. I will leave you with this. I tried to do a clean show. I've never been to this area of the country. And I tried to keep it clean for you guys. However, I am not so naive that I realize sometimes I tell a joke and people go, ha, 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 that was funny. Different group of people might go, that was offensive. Listen, if I said anything here tonight that offended anybody in any way, shape, or form by my language, my jokes, or my movements on this stage, that was not my intent. Please don't make a big deal out of it. If you do want to make a big deal out of it, I will meet you in the parking lot after the show. Guys, my name is Lucas Bohn. You guys have been great.